Oh, hello class. Well, for today's class, we're going to be talking about extremophiles. That's a word that means organisms that like extreme environments. But I think before we start, it's really important that we have a bit of context for what this term means. And while we may think we know what the word means, both parts of the word extremophile require a bit of caution when using them. The second part of the word, which is file, is one you might recognize from words like audiophile, which is someone who loves music, or cinephile, which is someone who loves books, or movies, I mean. Or if you have a really big vocabulary, maybe you're a bibliophile, which is someone who loves books. Well, here's one you probably haven't heard before. It's peristerophile. That describes me, actually. That's someone who loves birds. Except geese, of course. You know I don't like geese. Okay, so, do organisms that we call extremophiles actually love extreme environments? Well, I'm going to say probably no. I mean, I think some of them do actually thrive in extreme settings. However, many of them are probably more like tolerant of extreme environments. In other words, they can live there, but they might not be very happy about it. Okay, so we're going to go ahead and use the word extremophile anyhow, because it's the one that's been adopted for these organisms. So even if it isn't always accurate. But what about the other part of the word, extreme? Well, this seems kind of obvious, right? There's things we think of as normal, and then things that we think of as being very much outside of the normal range. Like when it's very, very cold or very, very hot, most people are uncomfortable in these conditions. Or when we have a pH that goes from, say, a strong acid to a strong base. Most people are very uncomfortable if they're exposed to strong acids or base. In fact, if they're very strong, they're usually deadly. So that's easy, right? There's no controversy there, right? Well, not exactly. Let's think about things on the geological time scale. For most of the history of Earth, there actually wasn't any oxygen in the atmosphere at all, or in some cases, just very little. And in fact, almost all early organisms, for them, oxygen was actually toxic. It was generated as a waste byproduct for cyanobacteria and eventually plants. And ultimately, it began to accumulate in our atmosphere in higher and higher concentrations. And, well, today those concentrations of oxygen in the atmosphere are actually around 20%. And if it gets much less than that, many organisms would not survive at all. At some times in the geologic past, though, oxygen was actually higher than it is today. How do we know this? Well, that's probably something that's going to have to be something we talk about in a future lecture. So let's just say there are a lot of ways we can determine from this, from both rocks and fossil records. Some of them involve things like counting the stomata on the leaves of fossil plants, for example. Okay, so if throughout most of Earth's 4.6 billion years, the atmosphere had no oxygen, which condition is the extreme one? The one where we have no oxygen? Or the one where the oxygen is 20%? What I'm getting at is, well, our perception of extreme is what we call anthropocentric. In other words, humans don't do well under very low or very high pressures. So for humans, for us, these are extremes, right? But if you're an organism that evolved in a sulfur-rich environment, that environment is completely normal for you. It's not extreme at all. Okay, well, I don't want to spend the entire lecture on semantics, but I do think it is important that we put a bit of context on this label, because we are applying human tolerances to non-human organisms. So let's get on with the weird and very cool critters that we call extremophiles. Okay, I'm going to introduce you first to a fancy scientific term. And this is one you probably haven't heard before, even if you're interested in extremophiles. This one is radiotrophic. The radio part is the same as radiation, and the trophic part means that's how the organism obtains food. Well, we will use the second part of this word trophic in future lectures. I am sure of this, so you should probably remember it. Okay, so radiotrophic means an organism that can use radiation as a food or an energy source. Now that is very curious. In a way, it's similar to how organisms like plants and algae use chloroplasts to generate energy, and essentially they are food for us because of it. Those are what we call autotrophs. So some fungi are thought to actually be able to do this crazy thing, this radiotrophic behavior. And well, why don't we try taking a look at one of these crazy organisms? Okay, this one is called Cryptococcus neoformans. And like most radiotrophic fungi, they're actually a little bit more like yeast or filamentous fungi, rather than something that looks like a mushroom you might find in your backyard. And in fact, some of them can actually cause infections in animals, including humans. Okay, so how do they do this? How can they use radiation as a food source? Well, they use natural pigments known as melanin. In some capacity, they use it to survive from the radiation itself. Melanin is an interesting pigment, though. It can absorb light and electromagnetic radiation. You might be familiar with the word melanin from the pigment that's found in human skin. When human skin is exposed to UV radiation, this initiates the formation of melanin, a process called melanogenesis. Essentially, it causes our skin to darken. But this pigment is also thought to absorb almost all of the UV radiation as well. And this has led scientists to think of melanin as a way that skin is protected from UV radiation. Does this mean that the pigment in human skin might also be a source of energy for us? No, not at all. Melanins are a pretty broad group of pigments, and the ones in humans are pretty different from the ones that we see in these fungi. Okay, so let's see. Plants make energy from light in a process that we all know is called photosynthesis. And what's happening in these fungi is essentially what you might call radiosynthesis. The first radiotrophic fungi were actually recognized as growing in the presence of ionizing radiation in 1991, a few years ago now. Do you have any idea where they might have been found? No? Okay, well, here's a hint. Think of a source of a lot of nuclear energy on planet Earth from about 5 years before 1991. Well, class, anyone have any ideas now? Aha! ASMR arsonist is correct. It's Chernobyl. Perfect. Okay, so it turns out that the water that was used to cool the nuclear reactors within the power plant was stored in some cement structures. And when people went back to look at stuff in Chernobyl, they found that these structures had turned black and they were covered by some sort of a strange fungus. And when they were very first observed, the scientists that were there, they noticed that not only was the fungus growing in this crazy environment filled with ionizing radiation, but they actually seemed to do better. They actually seemed to not just be tolerant of these conditions, but in fact actually kind of thrived in those settings. And for a few years, scientists tested all kinds of things, and they started looking for other organisms that maybe had a similar sort of behavior that could somehow get energy or maybe do better in radiation than in places where there wasn't any radiation. And they found three types of fungi that seemed to grow better when radiation levels were maybe even as high as 500 times higher than the normal background levels. And that just seemed sort of crazy to them. Well, to make this even more interesting, and perhaps even a little bit crazier, in order to study these fungi, they took them up to the International Space Station and stuck them outside of the space station itself. And they found that they were able to grow outside of the space station for several years in essentially this super high radiation of space. So why did they take them to space? Well, that's because the radiation in space is much greater than the radiation on Earth. And also, the background radiation in space is really kind of a different kind of radiation than most of the background radiation that we find on planet Earth. Space radiation is made up of atoms that have basically shed their electrons as they travel through space at speeds approaching the speed of light. So only the nucleus of the atom remains. The electrons are gone. We call this ionizing radiation. And ionizing radiation has enough energy that when it collides with matter, it can actually displace the electrons from another atom that they collide with. And as a result, when it passes through this material, it actually alters it. Now, on Earth, mostly we experience non-ionizing radiation. This is things such as, you know, regular old light and microwaves and, in some cases, UV radiation. Except perhaps when we use things like X-ray generating instruments, or in some cases where we get exposed somehow, hopefully inadvertently, to nuclear radiation sources. These are actually ionizing radiation. And one of the problems with ionizing radiation is it's more difficult to block. In other words, UV radiation can, for example, mostly be blocked by things like clothes or sunscreen. It's relatively easy to remain safe from UV radiation. Just go back inside your house, right? Okay, so, but ionizing radiation seems how it can penetrate substances and transform them as it goes through is really a lot more dangerous. Okay, so here are these fungi, and they're actually what we would truly consider to be extremophiles, because it seems like they actually prefer high radiation. They grow better in those conditions than they do when they're not exposed to radiation. So I think it's fair to treat conditions in outer space as an extreme environment for basically all living things from Earth, that is. And oddly, if you want to know really the strangest part of this whole story, it's that scientists have suggested that maybe we could use these radiotrophic fungi somehow to act as shields against ionizing radiation, because their bodies are filled with this melanin and it can absorb some of the ionizing radiation that hits it. So I mean this seems like a crazy idea, right? That we might coat stuff with some sort of a gross layer of fungi in order to make it resistant to ionizing radiation. But they've literally talked about this, you know, with the discussion of what's going on Mars today. You know, we have robots that are there, but if people are going to colonize Mars, one of the things that they need to be protected from is ionizing radiation. And this is pretty interesting. It's really sort of a narrative that occurs frequently when people start talking about extremophiles. The extremophile research is almost always tied to some concept of space exploration, or how organisms might evolve, or how they might live in space to somehow seed other life somewhere else. That's because extremophiles, they can live in these crazy conditions, as some of them basically just enjoying being bombarded with ionizing radiation. Okay, so this is just one example of an extremophile. Let's talk about some other extremophiles now. Actually, why don't we go all the way back to some of the very first extremophiles that we even recognized associated with radiation? Because this is a pretty interesting story in of itself. You know, very quickly after we learned about what radiation was, we came to understand how dangerous it was to almost all living things. Some of the very earliest work on radiation was done by the brilliant and famous scientist Marie Curie at the turn of the 20th century. And she dedicated the last 40 years of her life to understanding what radiation was. But it came with a price. Her death in 1934 has been attributed to long-term exposure to the very radiation she was studying. In any case, through this scientist's research and our exploration of radiation, we recognized that ionizing radiation was very, very dangerous to organisms. And we thought because it was so deadly to humans that it must be deadly to all organisms. And, you know, for most organisms, it is. And you might wonder how we found out that some organisms really weren't bothered by high doses of ionizing radiation. Well, this is where things get kind of interesting. In the 1950s, we started playing around with different ways to sterilize food, in particular, canned meat. You know, like Spam, the spiced ham in a can. Well, by the 1950s, the company behind Spam had sold 1 billion cans of canned meat. And canned meat was actually a staple. It fed many of the soldiers during the World Wars. And if we could find a way to cheaply and effectively sterilize the food, it could have revolutionized our ability to distribute canned meat. And one of the ways that scientists tried to sterilize canned meat was by exposing it to very high doses of gamma radiation. You know, like the stuff that made Bruce Banner famous and, well, ruined all of his pants. However, after they bombarded this canned meat with radiation at doses they thought would easily kill all living things, it's still spoiled. But why did it spoil? Ah, yes, because of this bacterium called Deinococcus radiodurans, which they were able to isolate from the spoiled canned meat after exposing it to radiation, and it was still alive. We should probably stop and give a little thanks to this little guy, because I don't think consuming irradiated canned meat would have been a great decision in our long run. I mean, I feel like we would have had some regrets. In any case, Deinococcus radiodurans, was one of the first recognized extremophiles. Its scientific name, radiodurans, the species name, literally means able to withstand radiation. And the other part of the name, the genus part of the name, the first half, what does it mean? A terrifying berry? Yeah, yes, that's right, yes. The translation of its name is literally a terrifying berry that endures radiation. We gave it that name. That was our decision. In fact, this bacterium is still one of the most radiation-tolerant organisms that we have ever found. And it's actually what's known as a polyextremophile. But that's just a fancy word that we added to extremophile to suggest that it can survive more things than just radiation. And that's because it can also survive extreme cold and dehydration and the vacuum of space and acid conditions and all of these things together, sometimes at once. What's interesting about this little guy, because, you know, sometimes when you're a bacteria, nobody wants to look at you, and they certainly don't want to learn your name as Deinococcus radiodurans. Well, they started calling this bacterium by a new name. Its new name? Conan the Bacterium. That's right. Because it was resistant to so many things, the scientists nicknamed it Conan the Bacterium. Crush your enemies, see them driven before you, and hear the lamentations of their canned meat. This is more reasonable than calling it terrifying berry, right? Let's just call this guy Conan for now. Okay. So, interest in this bacteria's ability to withstand radiation started a long tradition of irradiating organisms to see just how much radiation it takes to kill them. And since most people are not regularly exposed to radiation, we don't have a very good way to express radiation that people can easily conceptualize. The unit that we use for doses of radiation are called grays. What does that even mean? Well, okay, look at it this way. We'll put it into context of something that you probably, I may be familiar with at least on a little bit, that is a chest x-ray. So when you go to the doctor, let's say you've broken a rib, and you're exposed to a normal chest x-ray for a typical human, this is about 1 milligray. In other words, 1/1000th of a gray. About 5 grays, or let's say you had about 5,000 chest x-rays, that's enough ionizing radiation to kill most humans. Believe it or not, that's kind of what it takes to kill a human using x-rays. But it's actually a range. I mean, you don't just get 4,999 chest x-rays and then you're okay as long as you don't get the last one. But with most organisms, there's sort of tolerances that are based on our genetic differences within the species itself. And our response to dangerous things like toxins or radiation. It's variable, you know, for individuals within a population. In other words, not every person has the same genetic resistance to toxins or diseases, or in this case, radiation. In science, we use the term lethal dose, or just sometimes abbreviated LD, to describe different types or amounts of exposure to toxins, right? So how much is a lethal dose? And normally what we do is, if a population is exposed to something dangerous, we would categorize something as LD50 if whatever that toxin or dangerous thing is would kill 50% of the population that is exposed to that particular thing. So if it's radiation, for example, an LD50 of whatever that radiation is would kill half of the population that was being exposed to whatever that was. Well, you should make a note. Half of the exposed population will also survive it. But let's say we use the number LD100. Well, this is the amount or dose required to kill all of an exposed population. In other words, nothing lives. Some humans can actually withstand radiation basically twice as strong as other humans, or essentially 10 grays. But this is really, really the limit for our species. For human exposure, people exposed to 10 grays of radiation die. All of them. Oh, okay. Bruce Banner notwithstanding. So how many chest x-rays could we give Conan the bacterium before none of a population that was exposed would survive? About 15,000 grays are required to kill a typical Conan the bacterium. Now that's roughly 15 million chest x-rays for that bacteria. I mean, if the bacteria had a chest. By this point, because of their popularity on the internet, you probably know that water bears are also extremophiles, and that some water bears can also handle high levels of ionizing radiation. In fact, they've been to space as well. Well, how do water bears compare? Well, the most resistant water bears could take about 5 million chest x-rays. It's impressive, but it's not Conan the bacterium impressive. Or, if we want to look at Conan's cousin, Thermococcus, gamma tolerans. I know, that's a mouthful, but you can probably guess from the name where it got its name. It likes very warm conditions, and it can tolerate gamma radiation. So we just went ahead and named it after that. It takes about 30 million chest x-rays worth of gamma radiation to actually destroy a population of Thermococcus gamma tolerans. That's about twice as much as Conan the bacterium. It turns out that Thermococcus is also a polyextremophile. It's been found living in hydrothermal vents off the coast of California, in water that was nearly boiling. Up to 95 degrees Celsius. Hydrothermal vents are pretty interesting places, and we will, in the future, discuss them at much greater length, as well as the crazy organisms that live there. We will also probably have a couple more lectures eventually that deal with some of the other extremophiles that we might find interesting. I couldn't possibly cover all of them in just one lecture. Okay, since we've been focused mainly on radio-resistant organisms, let's stick with them and I'll cover a few more. Yeast and fungi and bacteria can clearly have amazing tolerances to radiation, but they aren't exactly the most charismatic organisms, right? I mean, they just look like little blobs most of the time. So what about some of the larger organisms? I mean, how do the multicellular organisms sort of stack up if we were trying to compare them to some of these single-celled critters that we can't even see? Well, among the vertebrate organisms, who do you think has the best capability of handling ionizing radiation? Would you believe goldfish? Yes, goldfish. I know when you were tuning into this lecture, you weren't thinking, I want to hear about how goldfish are extremophiles. But goldfish can actually handle about twice as much radiation as the most resistant humans can. But why goldfish? Well, it turns out that fish are often exposed to high amounts of UV radiation, and many aquatic organisms actually spend a lot of their time in shallow water, and they really don't have any way to avoid UV radiation. And goldfish cells take a lot of genetic damage from radiation, but they're actually capable of repairing this damage. And you know what? They're better at repairing this damage than humans are, and actually better than most other vertebrate organisms. In fact, you probably didn't know this, but there are goldfish living in the cooling ponds of Chernobyl today, and it appears that these goldfish have survived through those high levels of exposure to ionizing radiation after the power plant exploded. These levels of radiation killed many humans. Goldfish are pretty surprising organisms in many ways, actually. You probably didn't know that they are actually the only members of the animal kingdom that can see both infrared and ultraviolet light, as well as the visible light spectrum. Okay, well, you've probably been told at some point that if a nuclear reactor melted down, all that would be left on Earth is cockroaches. Well, how much radiation can cockroaches actually handle? Surprisingly, it isn't all that impressive, especially when compared with some of the other insects. Cockroaches could survive about 6 times more radiation than human beings, or, putting it in perspective, only about 3 times more radiation than goldfish. But by comparison, the common fruit fly, you know, this simple little organism that they run all of the scientific experiments on in your genetic classes in college, well, they can withstand about 10 times more ionizing radiation than a typical cockroach. Are you impressed? Oh, wait, there's more. What about this little wasp? It has a very difficult name to say. It is called a Habrobrachan hebeater. We haven't really given this thing a common name, but it can actually take about 2.5 times more radiation than a common fruit fly can. Well, okay, I've given you a lot of sort of comparisons, but how do they compare to humans? Well, this little wasp could handle about 158 times more radiation than would kill off the most resistant human being on planet Earth. I think even more than Bruce Banner. This organism's ability to withstand radiation is actually starting to encroach on tardigrade levels of radiation resistance. Okay, so what other organisms can withstand high levels of radiation. What about nematodes and amoebas? Well, you know, little guys that you find living in drops of water. Maybe when you were in elementary school, you looked at some of them in a microscope. Well, they both range in resistance somewhere between our mighty little wasp and the common fruit fly. What about our favorite, the tardigrade? Where do they fall out in this list? Well, water bears are, of course, polyextremophiles. What makes them so special? Why are they so resistant to radioactivity? Well, they can create a special state, a cryptobiotic state called the toon state, where their exoskeleton sort of transforms into something that's almost glass-like. This water bear that we see right here behind me, its name is Milnesium tardigradum. It's a common species of water bear. It's found in many, many places in the world, but it's been known to handle radiation levels that are about 50 times as much as the maximum human tolerance. And while that pales in comparison to Conan the bacterium and Thermococcus gamma tolerans, what makes it impressive is that Conan and his cousin, well, they're single-celled organisms, and water bears are multicellular organisms. I'm sure it's well known to you and probably anyone else who's even looked into water bears a little bit that at this point you know they can tolerate the vacuum of space and pressures greater than those that occur on Earth. And in fact, some water bears can handle temperatures ranging from minus 200 degrees Celsius, this is colder than ice, and temperatures as high as 150 degrees Celsius. That's 50 degrees Celsius hotter than boiling water. Of course, but the water bears have an advantage, and this advantage is their cryptobiotic state. A living water bear, one that's actually animated and walking around and, you know, doing their weird little baby crawl thing that they do, they're actually very sensitive to temperatures and pressures. It's only in their sort of cryptobiotic state that they can do anything special at all. They aren't indestructible, as many people tend to think. Those temperature ranges that I listed, those are the limits of them in their encysted state, and we only determine that they actually survive these conditions when the organism returns to a living state after they've been exposed to these conditions and still produce viable offspring. For an organism that lives in water, like water bears do, one of the most challenging conditions to live through is actually desiccation. That's a fancy science term for drying out. But water bears are known to be able to withstand being in a dehydrated state for decades. And then you just add a little bit of water and, well, they come back to life. What about pH? Check. They can handle very strong acids. What about no food? Yep. They can live up to 10 years or more in this cryptobiotic state without any food. Again, that's not a water bear in its active state. I don't want you to come away from this lecture thinking that a water bear can somehow crawl around without any energy, you know, and eat no food while it's doing this for 10 years. They can't. And in fact, most water bears, if they were left continuously in their sort of active living state, probably would only live for maybe at most a year. Some of them just a few months. Oh, so that's it, right? We've reached this point in the lecture where I've talked about the water bears, and, well, we probably just assume Water bears are the most radiation-resistant organisms in the animal kingdom because everybody loves water bears, right? Nope. The lovable water bear is probably the cutest of the polyextremophiles. Sorry, amoebas, but they aren't actually the most resistant to radiation. So, who is? And wait a second, why haven't you heard of them? Well, you're about to. This is the lowly deloid rotifer. It's actually capable of withstanding 100 times the amount of radiation that would kill a human. And if you were paying attention, that's twice as much ionizing radiation as the most resistant water bear. This is actually only topped by the most resistant of the resistant bacteria among all organisms. Rotifers are easily the most impressive of the radiation-resistant multicellular organisms of the animal kingdom. And guess what? They are also polyextremophiles. Similar to water bears, they are resistant to desiccation. And in fact, they are often found together in the exact same environments as water bears. Collect any lichen from the trunk of a tree, or some moss from a rock, or a fallen branch with a little speck of something on it, you know, that's living, and you are actually a bit more likely to find deloid rotifers in that setting than water bears. What else makes rotifers interesting? Well, deloid rotifers have lived for about 80 million years without any single one of their population having sex. You heard me. Not one of them in 80 million years has reproduced sexually. Let's stop here for a minute and learn a bit about what ionizing radiation does to organisms and why it's so dangerous. Ionizing radiation damages organisms by breaking the DNA strands themselves. So if we were to expose an organism to radiation and then look at their DNA, what we would find is that their DNA is completely shredded. It damages the cells. It kills most of those organisms. And you would think that it would make it nearly impossible to reproduce, since it should sterilize an organism if you break all of its DNA. At extremely high radiation doses, deloid rotifers only lay about 10% as many eggs as they normally would. Again, asexually. But neither the eggs nor the offspring themselves are sterilized by high doses of radiation. So how are rotifers able to withstand radiation, these crazy amounts of radiation, even as eggs? Are they somehow truly resistant to radiation damage? They are not. In fact, after high levels of radiation, the DNA of rotifers takes just about as much damage as the DNA of every other organism. What makes rotifers interesting is their ability to repair this damage. Kind of like the goldfish we discussed earlier. Genetic damage taken from radiation can be repaired. Only the deloid rotifers are so much better than other animals at it. In fact, actually, almost all of the organisms that we have discussed share this similar strategy. They aren't really resistant, such in the sense that they don't take damage from radiation. It's much more like They're just really good at healing from the damage that they take. I'm going to put this into mutant superhero power terms that maybe you're a little bit more familiar with. Most extremophiles aren't so much juggernaut, who could basically be invulnerable, as they are Wolverine, who can repair all of the damage he takes. So, aside from being miniature Wolverines, what ties together all of our most radiation-resistant extremophiles? Well, interestingly, it's the resistance to desiccation. It's their ability to withstand being dried out. And it seems like evolving some sort of pathway to become resistant to desiccation also somehow imparts a superpower of genetic repair from radiation damage. Water bears and rotifers and other organisms that can live in mosses and lichens and other subaquatic environments, they specialize in living through desiccation most of all. Okay, so let's get back to the part about them not having sex for 80 million years. Most multicellular organisms that evolve to become asexual go extinct. That's basically the next step. First you evolve asexuality, and then you go extinct. And exclusively asexual reproduction, it means that you cannot adapt to your environment. Your offspring are your genetic material. Whatever you are is what they are. Your gene pool is their gene pool. Your offspring are always clones. And there's no other source of diversity for these organisms. So if you aren't capable of withstanding some environmental condition, well, that's the end of the line. That's it for you, and probably for your entire species. And it turns out, almost all multicellular organisms, it's also the end of the line for them. You evolve somehow to become purely asexual, and the next thing you know, you go extinct. Except the deloid rotifers. For 80 million years, it's been ladies' night. Why can these strange multicellular organisms accomplish this when none of the other ones have? Well, it's very likely because their ability to repair the damage to their DNA means that any genetic mutations that might occur from radiation, they don't actually occur in these organisms. They just repair all of the genetic damage that they take. And as long as they are well adapted to their environments, then basically, if they could avoid predators and be fruitful and, you know, find resources and can lay eggs that are their clones, they probably don't need any genetic variability. They don't have to worry about having some mutation wipe them out, which is probably what happens to most asexual organisms. It means that sex is not necessary for them, and that's at least until something else comes along that they aren't really adapted for. Okay, well, that's my lecture for tonight. I suppose if you have some questions, I can try to answer them. But I want to say that extremophiles are a fascinating topic. And if you would like to check out some of the extreme organisms that I spoke about in the lecture tonight, you might want to check out my office hours this week, and probably many weeks during this semester. Because you know what we're going to do? We're going to take that microscope that's there on my desk, and we're going to hunt water bears, and deloid rotifers, and nematode worms, and amoeba, and many of the other organisms that I talk about here during my lectures. It will mostly be live microscope time, and then maybe a little chat between us, and I'll be answering your questions about tonight's lecture, or maybe more generally about extremophiles, while I explore some samples in the microscope. And it's also a good time if you have suggestions for some future topics that you're dying to have me tell you about. I'm willing to, you know, do whatever people are interested in as long as it's science. So I think you should drop by and check it out. It's going to be on Fridays, which is tomorrow night. Okay, well, I also want to thank one person for tonight's stream, and that is the artist known as Little Chook. She designed my amazing new office. Isn't it fabulous? You can check out her channel on Twitch TV if you'd like. Her name is Little Chook, and she streams at twitch.tv/Little Chook. Okay, let's see if I can find some questions. Here's one. You may have answered this, but what is your favorite extremophile? Ah, that's a question from the student named Sawneedle. I actually like water bears a lot. I think they're fun. I mean, they're cute, right? Everybody likes a water bear. But I think we'll find some of my most favorite extremophiles later on in our lectures. And I don't want to spoil it yet, so I'm not going to reveal it. But it's probably not a water bear. They're in the top five. Are there any more questions? I'm not seeing any. Okay. I don't want to drag the class out too long. You've been here. Oh, wait, here's one. Is the genetic damage the main danger of desiccation? But it seems like it probably must be related. And, you know, this is a question that scientists who study extremophiles are exploring. What is the relationship between desiccation and sort of surviving intense radiation? And clearly, they must be able to repair themselves when they've been desiccated. And somehow that repair is tied together with repairing yourself from UV or other types of radiation. Oh, here's a question from Fox Crossing. Hello, Fox Crossing. You know I love foxes. How old are tardigrades, speaking in evolutionary terms? Well, tardigrades have an interesting history. They have, in fact, lived through all five of our major geologic extinction events. So they're quite old. And they don't really belong to any of the other classes. They're in their own group, the tardigrades. So they're not a type of insect or anything else. They are basically tardigrades. Hypothetically speaking, if you took Conan out of the can, could you still have a good edible can of radioactive spam? This is a question from Angel. Well, Angel, I don't eat canned meat, and I would never eat canned meat. But theoretically, could we extract Conan from the can? Maybe. But I don't think you want to eat irradiated meat. The unknown. Could research on these creatures be used to help develop ways to repair damaged humans? Well, we hope so, right? This is actually one of the reasons why people study extremophiles. They want to try to see if we know something about how they repair things, well, then we could repair things. So perhaps it's a way of perpetually dealing with things like cancer or aging. People also study extremophiles because they find really innovative ways to sort of adapt to environmental conditions. And, you know, in tonight's lecture, we just talked about the radiophiles, those that are basically capable of withstanding high amounts of radioactivity. But, you know, there are many other types of extremophiles. And as we move through the semester, I hope to, you know, cover things like thermophiles and acidophiles and maybe some of the others, just so we can have a complete sort of idea of the kinds of things that they can withstand. Oftentimes people use a study or the research of extremophiles to tie it to, as I mentioned, some sort of planetary model for what early Earth was like when there was no atmosphere, or Mars, where there's no atmosphere or almost no atmosphere today. And sometimes people are just exploring them for means of new technology. Are there any other questions, class? Okay, well, I hope you all stop by and visit me during my office hours, and maybe we can look at some water bears and rotifers together, and I will talk a little bit more about each of them. But we can actually watch them crawl around in their actual environments, and we'll see how that goes. Okay, well, for now, I think it's time that we dismiss the class. I want to thank everybody for your attention. You've been great students, as always.